What's up, guys? Tony Regan, 37-year-old guy dealing every day with clinical depression and anxiety. And we're not talking enough. Everybody's talking, but nobody's saying anything. So let's get talking and let's say some shit. Just get in here. Everybody, like, subscribe, post, comment. Tell us your thoughts. We want to hear everything. Each and every last word. No contribution is too small. No contribution is too big. We're going to try and get all of this out there. We're going to talk.
You got something behind your eyes, the way you're talking, it's a cheap disguise. We were made to chase the light, but you got saved on a moonless night. Get free.
Tony Regan here, back for a long, long overdue installment of Thoughts on Race Day, even though I'm a day late and a dollar short on race day. I don't even really want to talk much about racing this week. I got so much other stuff on my mind. We'll talk some racing. So there was only one series that I'm into racing this weekend. It was NASCAR. They were running out of Las Vegas. First round of the playoffs. So what that means is that the top 16 cars in the series, they're in the playoffs now. So now it's on them to finish the best of all of the racers. No matter what happens, only one of those 16 drivers are going to be able to win the whole shebang-a-bang down at Miami Homestead. This is a newer system. I think it's been around like 5-10 years now. The Chase for the Cup is what they call it. And basically, it just kind of makes for good racing. Usually, you have to win an event or you get in on what are called playoff points. And the top 16... this week was the first round of the playoffs at Las Vegas. Now, not that anybody ever pays attention to any racing, but, you know, people might ask me, well, weren't they at Las Vegas earlier this year? Well, yes, they were. And one of the cool things about NASCAR is that they do a lot of their circuits twice. They'll do them once in like the spring, summer, and then they'll do them again in the fall for the playoffs. So that's actually kind of cool. They did Las Vegas this last week here. Martin Truex Jr. won. More importantly, Kyle Busch didn't win. So that kind of makes me happy. And he went on a bit of a tirade after the fact. He was getting upset about lap traffic and he was pulling the Marshawn Lynch, which is ironic because Marshawn Lynch was the guy that drove the pace car this week for Las Vegas. And you know, I saw a lot of real bullshit comments from people, man. I mean, it makes me sad that a sport that I love so much is also loved by like some serious bigots. A lot of people wondering what he's doing there. And yeah, I don't know, man. Like, I don't know. He's Marshawn Lynch. To me, he's like Dale Earnhardt Jr. or Joe Rogan. He can do no wrong. Like, he's Marshawn fucking Lynch. Get off me. Remember the earthquake run? Yeah. Oh, and by the way, yes, the Seahawks are 2-0. They're 2-0, and they're second to last place in their division because of the points scored. I am pretty scared to be in the NFC West. What'll probably wind up happening is that when the race season ends, we'll just swap over to Thoughts on Football Day, Thoughts on Game Day. I'm actually most excited for next week. Next week is the final race of the IndyCar IndyCar series. That'll be from Laguna Seca, which has one of the greatest elevation changes in racing, next to Bathurst. Or I think Spa's got some pretty good ones too for Formula One, but Laguna Seca it's a wicked track. Like I say, elevation changes. It's a road course, dedicated road course. It's pretty fast. That'll be the last race of the year, and guys are going to be pushing hard. So, you know, like I've said previously, IndyCar is totally back. I'm pretty excited about that. And then to top it all off, we're going to have Formula One from Singapore. Now, in Singapore, they do a night race. So they close off the streets of Singapore, turn on all the lights, and these guys race at night. One of the cool things about Singapore, there's a couple really cool things about Singapore. Number one is that the drivers, it's one of the most labor-intensive courses on the circuit. There's like 23 or 24 corners. And as street courses go, now remember, a road course is a dedicated course that just has turns to the right and all kinds of stuff. A street course is when they cordon off the downtown core or what have you, and they race there like they used to do with the Vancouver Indy, for instance. But Singapore is a unique one because it's a very wide street course. So there's actually one of the big complaints about street course racing is that overtaking or passing is super hard to do. Singapore doesn't have that problem. Singapore is a very, very fast street course. And they do it at night, which is just really cool. I think they also do Abu Dhabi in the United Arab Emirates. They do that one at night as well. But a Formula One night race is just really, really cool. And one of the great parts about that is that I do believe that because they're going to run it at night, we're not going to have to wake up at 4 a.m. to watch it like we normally do when they're running from Europe or Russia or what have you. So, yeah, if there's one Formula One, I know I say this all the time. If there's one race you want to watch, go and watch the next one. But Singapore is actually a really, really cool race. And I hope that you guys maybe just take 5-10 minutes out of your day if you see it, just to watch what I love so much about it. There's been Formula One has been a bit of a joke series with regards to it's just been Mercedes, 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 Mercedes. So my favorite driver, Lewis Hamilton, and Valtteri Bottas there, they've just been running game. But Ferrari came back real strong at Monza, Italy last week. Of course, they always do for Monza because Monza is Ferrari's home track. They used to run an oval there. And if you ever want to see some wild, wild shit, go to YouTube and look up Monza Oval. These guys were doing this in the 60s in Formula One cars. It was unbelievable. But yeah, Charles Leclerc, who's, I think he's a second or third year driver now, maybe a little longer than that even, but he's come up with Formula One, into Formula One and with Ferrari, and he's kicking ass and taking names these last few weeks here. And it's exciting to see some competition again because, like I say, it had just been Lewis Hamilton winning by 10 seconds here, 20 seconds there. And you know what else? Red Bull, Honda. Dude, Honda's coming back real strong. Max Verstappen is their main driver, and he's been doing really well lately. It's Formula One's getting interesting again, and it hasn't been that way for a long time. And, you know, it's an exciting time to be a race fan if you're like a lifelong race fan like myself, because there's a lot of cool things happening right now, and competition is getting better all the time, and camera angles are getting so much better all the time. And, you know, even if you don't watch the races on TV, all these series are so good now at posting race highlights on YouTube. And I actually think, because there's been this big talk lately around the racing world about the decline of racing fans, TV numbers are plummeting. In on-track attendance, at least for NASCAR, has been plummeting. And I think that a lot of it has to do with the attrition factor. NASCAR races are like 500 miles long usually. 400 miles is a short one. They'll do like a 350 or a 300 on a road course just because they don't know how to turn right. But generally, yeah, you know, one of the things that set NASCAR apart was that it isn't just a sprint. It's a marathon. It's kind of a I would call it a sprinter's marathon. And it just feels like, not just in racing, but in the world in general, our attention spans are just, we need two or three different sources of information. At least I do. At least this is just what I do. I mean, I will have racing on the TV and I'll put it on mute unless Dale Earnhardt Jr. is doing the call, just because he gets so fucking excited, man. It's hard not to be excited when he's watching a race. But generally speaking, I will put a race onto my TV, put it on mute, and then I'll have a video playing in the background on my phone, and then I'll be playing a game on my phone at the same time. So that's literally three different sources of stimulation going on at the same time. And, you know, this is something that's I think is relatively new to the human experience. You know, it's all happening very fast, and information comes in so fast. And I think it's hard for us now to just sit down and watch a race for 4 hours. I'm not even going to lie. I love putting NASCAR on the TV and then playing chess on my phone, or lately I've been into SimCity for my Super Nintendo emulator on there. You know, or Facebook or YouTube or whatever. Like, it feels like now that I have all of these options for taking in media, that I'm trying to maximize them. And I think that it kind of, you know, we as a society, as a collective, we're starting to get addicted to the dopamine spike of the notifications. You know, every time we see a like, we get a dopamine spike. Every time somebody comments on something, we get a dopamine spike. And back in the day, you used to have to use some kind of a substance, or you'd have to watch sports highlights on the regular to get dopamine spikes that fast. But now it almost seems like the only thing we're really doing as a society is looking for that next dopamine spike. And I don't know if that's a bad thing, but I think we're in this weird transitional period where, you know, none of us really know what to do with ourselves anymore. Yeah, I kind of trailed off there a little bit, didn't I? I don't even remember where I was with the racing aspect of it. I'm starting to talk about life and shit. Yeah, what else is going on in the world? Well, prices at the pump might go up another 10 cents a liter or whatever because of this unpleasantness in Saudi Arabia. I don't know if anybody's been paying attention to that, but they're calling it a terrorist drone attack on a refinery that puts out 5% of the world's oil supply on any given day. And I know that doesn't really sound like much, and I know that the initial reports over the last 2 days were saying upwards of 50% of the world's oil supply is going to be cut off and blah 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 blah, which is horse shit, right? I mean, we have contingency plans for contingency plans for this kind of shit normally, but man, I don't know how a terrorist organization gets a drone like this. Like, this drone, it was a drone that attacked this refinery setup, this oil production facility. And, you know, there is conjecture going around right now that the attacks were launched from Iran and that Iran is behind it. But they're also calling it, I think they're the Houthi rebels, or I don't know, man. It's very, very convoluted and strange. And I don't understand how a terrorist organization gets its hands on a full-scale working military drone. Unless you start to think about how Iran shot down that American drone a couple of years ago. Maybe they've back-engineered something. I don't know. It's all very, very bizarre. And, you know, I don't know. I don't want to get too conspiratorial or anything like that. But, you know, just last week, I saw this report about how there was a glut of oil in the world and that prices were just going to plummet and plummet and plummet. And here we are now with an excuse to at least keep the prices steady. You know, I make no secret that I am pro-Canadian oil for a variety of reasons. not the least of which is that, you know, this kind of shit doesn't generally happen in Canada. I think we're going to start to see more of it with eco-terrorism and stuff, you know. But for everybody that's against the pipeline, yeah, I understand, you know, the environmental impact. If one drop of oil hits water, I get it. I grew up swimming in the Burrard Inlet at Old Orchard Park. I can remember when I lived in Port Moody, living up April Road there, we would sit on the deck and we would watch oil tankers come in to the Burrard Inlet and offload at one of the, God, I don't even remember how many. Well, let me think. There was Chevron, Petro-Canada, Shelburne, Imperial Oil. Fuck, I know there's another one that I'm missing, but at any given time in Vancouver, there were four or five working refineries right on the water. And I mean, I'm sure it probably happened. You know, media coverage wasn't as good back then as it is now, but I don't remember hearing about anything hitting water. I know it did. I'm sure it did. It would have had to. But, you know, we have to look at things on an international scale, and in order for us to continue to maintain the protection of our environment, we need to be fiscally independent. We need to have money coming in. And I know that a lot of people are against oil and gas, and you know, I can understand exactly where that comes from. I really do. You know, it's a complicated thing for me because I live in Alberta, which is literally the oil and gas capital of Canada, maybe even North America. I mean, I don't know if there's anywhere else in North America that's doing more for oil production than we are, or at least we were, you know. But yeah, like I can agree with, I wholeheartedly agree that, you know, lithium ion or whatever the next battery technology is going to be will be the future. I firmly believe that we should be doing more with regards to wind and solar and alternative thermal, man, geothermal, dude. We should be all over that stuff. Frankly, I wouldn't care if the oil companies bought the technology, patented it, and figured out a way to clean it up but charge us the same amount. Like, it's not about how it would be cheaper or anything else. I mean, I understand these are corporations, right? And these corporations are funded by guys like me that own shares in these companies. And yeah, everybody can talk about the 1% and the 1% whatever. You know what, you can very, very easily, if you play your cards right, you can make capitalism work for you too. And you know, so these companies, they have to do something. And not just the companies, but us. I would like to see, and I know that, like, I'm a staunch capitalist and I love capitalism. I believe that a product that sells should sell and a product that sucks shouldn't. Nobody should be forced to buy something because the government says this is what it is. Like, I'm anti-communist. I am pro-capitalist all the way. But I wonder if maybe we don't need to reevaluate what we're doing with our energy. I mean, if nothing else, why can't we pull this stuff out of the ground here, refine it here, and sell it to ourselves for 20 cents a liter? Like, you know, think of the, you know, everybody talks about trickle down economics, but think of the trickle up economics if we're only paying 20 cents a liter for our gas. You know, and I know there's definitely ways that we can do carbon capture, which is something I think we need to be on top of until we can become fully green, if you want to call it green. But yeah, so I don't know. I'm tangenting here right now. But long story short, it's things like Saudi Arabia and various ship seizures in the Gulf of Oman that if nothing else, they should really, really hammer home how important it is to be energy independent. And we're Canada. We're sitting on all of this shit. We could be so energy independent if we wanted to. We could just refine this stuff ourselves, sell it to ourselves dirty cheap. We would create jobs. You know, I would even go so far as to offer government grants to universities. I think that until we can really, truly get to a spot where we're at zero emissions, what if we gave a $5 million grant every year of taxpayer money to a university that comes up with the best solutions for, let's say, five major problems with energy? So, like, you know, a $5 million grant to the best carbon capture idea, a $5 million grant to the best way to improve efficiency in combustion engines, a $5 million grant to environmental reclamation, which I think is maybe the most important part of all of this. I see it every day. Well, at least I did when I was selling power sports equipment. Environmental reclamation is a very, very big part of what happens here in Canada with regards to oil exploration and all that, that not a lot of people consider. But, you know, I think that there are ways that we can do all of this, all of it. We can do research and development on green energy. We can start implementing green energy. But until we do, I think we need to focus on carbon capture and efficiency. And like I say, you know, what if we just gave a couple of grants to universities that came up with the most viable ideas, have them peer reviewed by an international panel? You can do all of this shit on Facebook or whatever nowadays. Like, you know, let's start throwing some ideas around. And, you know, if oil becomes this thing that we no longer need, but the rest of the world does, well, then that's like literally selling the dog shit out of your backyard. Right? Like we could make a fortune. We could create jobs. Yeah. Anyway, I know a lot of people are going to disagree with this sentiment, but I stand behind it. Oil and gas is too big to fail now, and we have to do something in the meantime to secure our own energy and make it so that between hurricanes and war and terrorism and everything else, we need access to our own gas. We need a refining capacity back here in Canada. Yeah, maybe another thought for another day there. What else is going on? I feel like I really want to contribute this week because I was out last week, had a tonsil infection and wasn't really in the mood for talking. What else is going on? Oh, well, I'm about week three into my new job in the cannabis industry here in Alberta. And let me tell you, it is maybe next to pumping gas when I was 16, 17 years old. This is the most fun I have had in a job in a very long time. Everybody comes in super happy. Everybody comes in like nobody's in a bad mood. And let me tell you something. I made some stupid fucking mistakes the other day. I gave two different customers the wrong product, even though there's literally a three-step fail-safe process for this shit. And I just skipped two of the steps because I was worried about time and how long I had had my customers waiting. And you know what? I fucked up big, man, twice. This would have been like somebody asking for vodka and I gave them peppermint schnapps. Like, this was no, these weren't small fuck-ups either. And so I let that really drag me down for a couple of days. I've been staring at the wall for the last couple of days. No bullshit. Although something like this that before would have had me staring at the wall for a week, I was only staring at the wall for 2 days, which for me is a marked improvement. You know. And it's one of those things too, because Like my coworkers, they're not mad at me at all. Like my bosses, nobody's mad at me. I'm just mad at myself that I made that mistake. Not even so much about, you know, human error is human error and it can happen, but there are steps that are in place and I got cocky and I thought that, oh, I can just bypass these. I got these poor guys waiting out there. And I got cocky, man. I got greedy. A great man named Sean Fogali, may he rest peacefully, would say, "You got greedy, Tony." Yeah, it's true. I got fucking greedy. Thought I was slick. Totally wasn't, but, you know. So that had me dragging myself down for the last couple of days, and I've been pretty low. Mood wise, and I'm just kind of starting to shake it off now, but like I say, man, it's better now. I can shake it off in 2 days instead of in 2 months like it used to take. So, you know, making progress every day, making progress. Yeah, what a fascinating industry it is too. It's happening really, really quick. And the customers are just fantastic. Like people, nobody's coming in to buy weed to be in a shitty mood. Like I haven't seen it yet. I haven't seen it. I've probably dealt with 500 people maybe in the last 2-3 weeks that I've been there. And nobody has really been upset about anything. Yeah, the odd person talks about the price and how they can get their other stuff way cheaper from wherever. But I will also tell you that a lot of the feedback that I'm getting is that the store-bought shit is just that much better. The fit, finish, quality, and you know, these guys test and retest and retest their THC levels and their CBD levels. Like, we all know what we're getting every time now. And I will tell you that people come in and they say, "I want this." Like, they know what strain they want. They know the manufacturer that they want. Yeah, like this first year has been an absolute, just, it's been, I don't want to call it a shit show because it's generally been very positive. A bonanza, a land grab, I guess is what I would call it. Yeah, it's, you know, it's also good to know that I'm not the most chronic person in the world. I used to have concerns that, you know, maybe I was consuming a little too much of this stuff, but no, I see some regulars, man. And, you know, perspective is never a bad thing, is it? But yeah, absolutely love the industry. My coworkers are fantastic. The company I work for, I don't know if I'm allowed to plug them, so I won't, but, you know, if you know what time of day it is, if you know what I mean, just look up that time of day and you'll find a company that is really, really, really good at what they're doing. I am so, so impressed with the communication and the infrastructure and the openness, and it's a fantastic industry to be in. You know, for all you people out there that are employers, I will tell you this: hire potheads. No, really. Hire some potheads. You want to know why? Because we're lazy. And we will find the most efficient way to do every job every time. If we're given a little bit of space, you know, well, dude, this could be done so much better if we just did this. You know, and it feels like I'm involved with a company of like-minded individuals that get it. I mean, everything is so efficient. The computer system is amazing. The education system is phenomenal. Phenomenal. We have a full-time medical doctor on our staff. He works solely for my company. And the guy is a wizard. with regards to the medicinal properties of cannabis and terpenes. And oh man, if you guys want to go down a rabbit hole, look up terpenes. I didn't even know this, but apparently if you want to get higher, eat mangoes. Didn't know that. If you want to take the buzz away, eat spicy food. Also didn't know that. Could have saved myself a lot of panic attack walks down along the river all through the 90s if I knew that I just had to chew on some peppercorns to make it go away. But yeah, just, you know, for all the negativity that I've been imposing upon myself, it's a pretty exciting time for me. It's good. If I take the time to take a step back and look at things from a point of view of, you know, perspective on past, present, future, I'm doing pretty good right now. Things are good. My mental state is better than it's probably ever been. Even though I've had a shitty week, generally speaking, my mental state has been leaps and bounds above where it's ever been before. I have a job again, so I've got that purpose back. And I'm getting to be my silly self with customers. I can crack jokes with people. I'm having fun. And the only thing I got to do is just slow down a little bit and check and recheck what I'm doing. And if a person has to wait an extra 30 seconds to get their bag of weed, well, at least they're not hanging out behind a Domino's pizza for 30 minutes for a guy that has their money and may not come back. You know, it's, I got to try to put these things into perspective. And even just talking here on the Security Sex Media podcast and, you know, just venting this stuff, even as I'm listening to myself talk about it, I'm really gaining a lot of perspective here, and it helps. And you know what? I want to thank you guys for listening. It really means a lot to me that you click and that you share and that you like, and you know, the Get In Here page on Facebook, I think at last check we were at 80 members, and it's barely been 2 months, I think, maybe 2 months. So I'm pretty happy with that. I haven't been overly, I've kind of been selectively inviting people that I think would be interested, but you know, please don't be shy about inviting friends, or, you know, keep posting. I love seeing the memes. I love seeing, you know, the uplifting messages, and I love seeing the funny stuff. I love the engagement and the communication that's going on the Get In Here page, and it makes me super, super happy. So thank you guys all so much for continuing to contribute. Believe it or not, even though we're just looking at memes, we're actually helping. I firmly believe that we're actively helping people right now, just giving people a place to vent and stuff. And, you know, so don't stop the music, man. Keep it coming. You know what? As always, you can check us out. Like I say, securitysucksmedia.com. Get In Here. There's going to be a wicked podcast launching tonight with a buddy of mine who was in the British Royal Air Force. He was an airplane mechanic. I am so excited to hear his fucking contribution, man. Oh, I'm just, you know, hell, I started this vlog feeling pretty bummed out about life, and I'm ending it feeling it pretty good. So let's not ask what's in the hot dog. Let's just enjoy the hot dog. What do you say, guys? And as always, y'all get in here. Thanks for checking out the latest contribution to the Security Sucks Media podcast team. I'm Tony, and just wanted to thank you guys for coming by and checking it out. Do not feel shy about commenting, posting, sharing. I want to see smoke signals. If you don't have a phone, invest in carrier pigeon. Talk to your mailman. Tell him you're listening. Get it out there and get them in here. And you get in here too.